A nice lime pop.
Yeah, Debbie Jordan brings me that occasionally. I told her once I liked lime pop.
To me, like, lime pop feels like a 50s type thing. Was it? Is that true, or is it a new thing?
Lime Ricky used to be called, and it was in the 50s. But the pop shop is the newer thing, I think it...
Yeah, that brand is new, I know, yeah. Yeah, it just feels like one of those old school things. But yeah, it was like those weird pops.
Could have even been earlier than the 50s, for all I know. But yeah, you could always go down into the Coke machines that and they used to come kind of along, have to go along on a track. When you put your money in, you lifted up the top, and they went along on a track, and the pop came out. And every place, all these local stores and things that you go to, always had all weird pop like that. And there was a lemon one, this, orange, of course. It wasn't strawberry, but it was a pink pop. I don't know what it was, but anyway.
Yeah, it's one thing I liked about Japan is, like, we really, once we have our stuff, it's kind of set in stone. Like, you know, we've just had O. Henry bars forever, and, you know, just whatever. You just go to the store and you know what there's going to be. In Japan, it's like always cycling. It's always new stuff. So the bad part is, like, if there's something that you like and then it's gone, it ain't coming back. It's gone. But it's cool to just see different stuff.
There's always new stuff to try. Yeah.
It's like they have insane amounts of vending machines. It's like you can't exaggerate how many vending machines there are. They're fucking everywhere. But it could be kind of fun. Like when I got there was this temporary thing that was like a cold coffee in a can, but it was like a strawberry latte. And there was a banana kind too. But the strawberry one was super rare. And I would, like, every vending machine I went by, I'm just like, because who cares, right? There's a million things I could get. But just because that was the one that was new and weird, I was always looking for it. And it would take days until I would find it. And like, fuck yeah. And like, it wasn't really that great. It's just fun because it was so rare. But yeah, it's neat how the machines are just everywhere. Well, they still have two like cash-based society. They're all about coins and money, so I don't know. I guess it just makes sense that there's vending machines everywhere. But I don't know, it's cool.
The trouble with our vending machines is if you're using coin, you never know when it's going to just suck your coin in, and that's it. You're not going to get the product. Now, maybe somebody who comes along eventually gets all that stuff. It all just kind of lets loose, but that's why our vending machines get all beat to hell.
Yeah, and the weather too, like we can't really just have them outside. But yeah, Japan definitely prides itself in all their stuff working and being in, and prides themselves in, you know, not ruining public stuff or whatever, the two things combined. But yeah, that happened to me once in Toronto. It was like 3 a.m. and I was walking home and I was just parched and I was so thirsty. And down by the waterfront, what is that? I can't remember what it's called anymore. But anyway, there's like a sugar factory. I can't even remember my Toronto landmarks anymore, but I found a vending machine in the middle of the night and I had a toonie. I had just enough to get a stupid drink, and that exact thing happened. It took the money, nothing came out. And it's in the middle of the night and I'm so thirsty. It's just like, fuck, man, come on. Like, dude, that's so demoralizing. All right, so we're back into game shows this week.
Okay.
So this time it's Beat the Clock.
Oh, I remember Beat the Clock. I don't remember what it's all about, but yeah. Okay.
From what I can gather, it's just they give people a minute to do something, and you got to beat the clock.
And how long did it run for?
So this one, it was started on the radio in 1948, and it was called Time's A-Wastin'. And then in 1949, they changed the name to Beat the Time. And then in 1950, they put it on TV, called it Beat the Clock. And it was hosted by Bud Collier, who I just know that name.
Yeah, me too.
And it turns out, maybe I just know him from Beat the Clock, but he also was the guy who did the voice of Superman on all the early radio and cartoon stuff.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I mean, I just feel as I worked at a comic shop, so maybe that's how I... Because I've just heard that name. And in these early episodes, there's his co-host is named just Roxanne, just a single name.
So then how long did it run for?
Well, I'll get to that. So, and this Roxanne chick, she... I looked her up, and it's one of those, like, best known as co-host on early Beat the Clock, you know, like, didn't really do anything else. So it was canceled in 1958, but not really, because they brought it back over and over and over and over up until 2019. They did a kids show version. So it came back, like, so many times. It just almost never stopped. But the first time they revived it, they tried to get old Bud back on as the host, but he said he just wasn't feeling up to it. He just was a little under the weather or whatever. And then he died in 1969 of a circulatory ailment. So this episode is from 1953. It's not right at the start, but again, because most of those early ones just don't exist. And I thought this was interesting. On the little article I read about it, they went out of their way to mention that there were no scandals about this game. Like, I think that says more about game shows of the time, that they would have these controversies about if the game was fixed or not, and, you know, behind the scenes weird game show stuff. And none of that with this show. This show was, like, so casual that if somebody really tried hard and failed, sometimes he'd just give them the thing, so who cares? So I just thought it's funny to mention what didn't happen. Mm-hmm. It didn't have any tomfoolery going on. And then on this YouTube video that we're going to watch, one of the commenters just mentioned that there's a six-year-old girl in this episode, and that that girl is now 76 years old. So think about it, you know? Like sands through the hourglass, these are the days of our lives. So yeah, beat the clock. That's all I got.
All right, let's see what we've got.
Oh, yeah, and I can't remember the company, but again, it's like there's always the, you know, just one company that that sponsors these early shows. So this is some product line that doesn't exist anymore, but I guess we'll find out, but I don't remember what it's called.
My God, I think this is the first time we've been watching it in daylight.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, the combination of I got here a little early and the days are finally getting a little longer. It's not bad. Sylvania. You ever heard of that company?
Sylvania. I would think light bulbs. Yeah.
Guess we'll see.
Century, a quality name in incandescent bulbs.
Oh, shit, you called that one.
Right now, this is Bud Colley speaking for Sylvania, hoping that next time may be your time to beat the clock. Good night, everybody.
That was certainly entertaining.
Yeah, it ended on a little bit of a down note just because the only person that didn't succeed was the very last. They didn't not succeed, but they cut them off halfway through a 55-second thing. That was weird, but I guess just so they'll come back next week.
But that'll make you come back. That'll make you want to watch it next week, too. Yeah. That's like the cliffhanger.
So I guess, yeah, just compared to Truth or Consequences, which is the other game show we watched, like this is sort of similar because they had them do little tasks, but they only did like two of them in the whole half hour on Truth or Consequences. They just talked to Bob Barker for like 15 minutes. Where this show, yeah, we noticed that
they had one, two, three, four, at least four.
Yeah, and the first one happened even with the sponsor message within 2 minutes. Like they were just like, let's move, let's just do this thing. And yeah, it was good, it was funny.
Yeah, I can see that being a very popular show.
Yeah, much, much better. Because yeah, I gotta admit, when I was like, oh, you know, game show, okay, I'm not. It just, on the surface, the game show weeks seem less interesting than when we watch normal shows, but that was kind of good.
And the host is real upbeat.
Yeah.
Real upbeat. Real conversational, too. Like, he has those kids on there, and he draws them right into the conversation and jokes around with them and has a few little tongue-in-cheek little asides with them that I don't think they caught, but whatever. No, he's very good. No, that was extremely entertaining.
I like too just seeing those little moments where he has to think on his feet, like this Roxanne chick who was his co-host. I guess she had her own doll, so they're giving all the kids these Roxanne dolls. It's like, we got some Roxanne dolls for you. You got them ready? Oh, she's busy. Well, you know, just like, or the way he would mid sentence not remember what the person's last name was, but look down at his little card. Like, yeah, he was pretty slick. I can see why they wanted him back, you know, for the reboot.
Yeah, no, that's probably of all that we've seen that's in that genre, that is definitely the best.
I like, too, that it was just so casual and kind of low stakes, because, yeah, they just find it kind of, it's like that secondhand embarrassment you feel for people when, like, because all these people are so awkward and stiff. Like, they're not TV people, they're just normal families, and they got to do these silly things on TV, but they're so easy about it here that they're just like, hey, whatever, you know, like, oh, that one failed, that's okay, you still get this, or like they said in that article, like, just giving away prizes. Yeah. Like, who cares?
Yeah, they didn't make anybody feel bad,
and it's obviously just the whole thing was just an ad for Sylvania lighting company or whatever. So yeah, why make it tough? Just give away stuff, it's a free ad, you know.
Yeah, so that's got our, that's got my vote.
Yeah, that was good.
I'd recommend anybody take a look at that.
I can see why it came back.
For a laugh.
A million times, yeah. And like so many different weird things, like different little, so many of them were balancing, right? I was saying like, I guess I don't think I have the sense of balance these people have. Like I was amazed they did any of that. Like balance this thing on your hand and all this crazy
shit.
Put it
on a chair that you, that's got stripes on it that you can't see because you're under the chair.
Yeah. Or like a good example is, yeah, this weird dumb one they did where it's just, a guy has to knock down little signs with different weather, and whatever weather is on the sign happens to him just so they can dump snow on him and dump water on him. But then when they dumped hail, it knocked down the sign that said sunny, which is all he was trying to do. So they just gave him the thing. They're like, ah, the weather blew it down. You win. You know, like that's just it's nice. And it's funny, too, the sort of evolution, I guess, of these shows where every single person won the grand prize, and it was always a Sylvania TV, where I'm just used to, you know, The Price is Right or whatever, where it was always a different, you won a cruise, and they talk about the cruise.
Yeah, they gave away four Sylvania TVs.
Yeah, but I wonder at what point, like, somebody realized, like, hey, you know what, we could give away four different things, but they hadn't thought of that yet, they just... And man, this Sylvania company, like I looked them up, they seem to still exist as like some conglomerate that's just not really America based anymore. But it was getting into some hardcore weird nerdery of like, if you have a 1953 video camera, this is the kind of bulb you want for your home movies and all this stuff. And I'm like, were people doing that back then? I guess they were. I don't know.
Well, not, I don't think that so much. People were making home movies. But up to, before that, the average Joe wouldn't have never ever been able to have any of that stuff. He might have had a camera with a flash on it,
yeah,
which they promoted big time, too. But, yeah, early, that would be early domestic home movies.
I guess they must have existed in the 50s. I always just think of, like, the Wonder Years, you know, where they always show those old Super 8 videos and stuff. But I always think of those as, like, the 60s. I didn't really realize that in 1953 there even was a consumer option for a video camera, but yeah, it must have been crazy expensive, like, man.
Yeah, well, and the TVs, those TVs that they were giving away, those would have been very expensive in 1954.
Yeah, I guess that's what I'm noticing, I guess, with Sylvania, is, like, most of the other sponsors we've seen, it's just Crisco or some shaving stuff, or it's, like, very low-end kind of stuff, and this was, yeah, like, expensive-ass shit, so yeah. That's a little unusual.
Yeah, nice prizes, nice show. I really enjoyed that. I would watch that again. If this was the 1954 and that show was on, I would go out of my way to make sure that I watched it because it was so entertaining. And we laughed all the way through it. Yeah. We couldn't believe half the stuff they were making these people do. And they were doing it.
Yeah, not bad. So, yeah, again, I guess, yeah, I can understand why it constantly comes back over and over because, yeah, why not? And it makes sense, too, that the last one was a kid's show because it, you know, like, well, like, it's like they were kind of inventive, like the one where they had the husband and wife both put on like a cardigan and button it up, and then they had these huge fluffy pillows and they had to stuff the pillow down each other's back at the same time. It's just silly, just a dumb thing to do, but they did it, and then you get the funny visual that they look like hunchbacks, and then they win $100. So I mean, everybody's happy. Cool. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's all there is to say about that. It's a pretty good show.
Pretty
definitely
good show.
I guess we've always got like our kings of different stuff, like the king of the sitcom is definitely
Jack Benny,
and the king of the game shows is Beat the Clock so far.
So far, yeah.